native woodlands would obviously have had herbivores in them. I'm here in the Scottish pine woods at Abernethy RSPB reserve, and this would have had wild boar, it would have had moose, it has deer as it has now. In the lowlands, perhaps there are aurochs, the ancient ancestor of cattle. So one of the issues is, if we are to manage these woodland habitats, do we want to think about reintroducing herbivory into these systems? And to discuss this question, I'm here with Richard Mason. So what's your role here, Richard?
So I'm Abernethy Conservation Manager. I've been here for 5 or 6 years, and I manage the warden team, and together we deliver the conservation projects, management and monitoring projects here on the reserve.
So what are you doing about this herbivory issue?
So we're doing a couple of things. So we've got a long-term research project, which is comparing the impact of cattle grazing and cutting of vegetation with a control area, to see what impact that has on invertebrate communities, vegetation communities, and importantly for us here on capercaillie.
And so what have you actually been doing?
So in here we've been robocutting. So robocutter is a machine, a remote controlled flail mower, mm-hmm. which can be driven around the forest, and you can decide which bits you cut and which bits you leave. And in here we're stood in an area that was cut about 5 years ago, and it's now about 4 or 5 inches tall, a mixture of heather and blaeberry. And then next to us are some uncut areas, which are up to 2, 2.5 feet tall, which have not been cut.
So it's remarkable that there's still that difference 5 years later, that it's obviously set back the vegetation quite a lot. And do you think this community we have here is what you're looking for?
Yeah, so the habitat in here looks pretty good for capercaillie. If you were to look at a textbook of how your field layer should look for capercaillie, this wouldn't be far off. A good mixture of vegetation heights, a lot of short vegetation dominated by blaeberry. That's important because it allows the broods to move around the forest before they can fly. And young blaeberry also has a very high density of invertebrate species and biomass, particularly caterpillars, which is a critical food source for capercaillie chicks. So the cutting in here, we think will have increased the amount of food and the access to food for capercaillie chicks to help their breeding productivity.
And are you monitoring and testing this?
Yes, so we have a network of sample points in this area where we monitor the response to the vegetation, invertebrates, woodland birds. We also monitor capercaillie productivity using camera traps, which we put up at capercaillie dust baths. And through that, we can see broods of capercaillie, young chicks, and the chicks getting older and reaching full size.
And you're also doing this in experimental scale too?
Yes, so we've got kind of two scales. We've got a 200 hectare plot scale that we're monitoring very intensively. And then we've expanded the work beyond that to about 1,500 hectares of the forest where we're either cutting or grazing.
So and then as I understand it, you've got treatments that you cut, treatments that you graze, and a control treatment. And should we go and have a look at some grazed areas?
Let's go and have a look.
So we've heard that cutting can work. So what are the consequences of grazing? So tell me, Richard, what are we seeing here?
So in here, we're in another area of the forest where we've been grazing with cattle. And there's been cattle in here for 5 years. Over winter, a mixed herd of Highland and Shorthorn, some crossbreeds, provided by a local farmer who brings the cattle in October each year, and they stay in here until about February or March.
And do you think that works?
I think it looks really good, and I think what's interesting in here compared to the robo-cutting is that the grazing is much more variable in its impact. So we're stood in an area here quite near to a track where the cattle have obviously spent a good amount of time, and I can see bits of bare ground. I can see a succession of plants coming through onto that bare ground, like foxgloves and wood sorrel, which are otherwise quite scarce in the forest. But then as we go further away from the track, the impact is less and can be quite subtle and hard to see. But the impact is largely on the heather, so reducing the dominance of heather largely through trampling, and also forming pathways and tracks where the cattle move between water sources and between good grazing. And those paths are used by capercaillie, particularly hens with broods and chicks, to move around the forest. So whereas the cutting is quite binary, it's either cut or it's not cut, the grazing is much more variable in its impact.
So do you think capercaillie have used this site?
So they have, yeah. So we've seen a number of capercaillie droppings around here, some fresh, some old. And just over here is a great sign. This is a capercaillie dust bath. So it can be hard to see, but there's a sort of bowl shape here in this sandy soil. And the capercaillie come in here to help them molt feathers and to help them clean their feathers using sand. And they also peck at the grit here for their digestion. And scattered around it, we've got some feathers. So there's a beautiful hen feather. And we've got some droppings dotted around as well. In here. So we know capercaillie are using this area, and this is pretty typical. So where we have capercaillie present in the forest, where we've grazed, we usually see quite quick response and usage of those areas by capercaillie.
So you're monitoring the experiment both show that this seems to be an effective thing to do.
Yeah, so we've been grazing now for 5 years, and we monitor the leks, and we also monitor the productivity. And in our main grazing area, our lek count has actually gone up from 3 male birds before the cattle arrived to 13 male birds just this year, which is it's a pretty remarkable increase for capercaillie. It's really exciting. And alongside that, we've seen a good number of broods picked up on camera traps from the grazed area, including some really big healthy broods of 5 or 6 fully grown chicks, actually in each year that we've monitored them. So the signs are looking really good for the grazing.
But then I guess the obvious question is that famously you reduced the density of deer and yet you're introducing a different herbivore. That seems paradoxical. Why is that?
Yeah, well, that's true. And so deer here are a really important part of the landscape and the ecosystem. And although we manage deer to reduce the density so that our forest can expand, we still have a good number of deer here. But those deer have quite a different impact on vegetation and on the ground than cattle. They're much smaller, and they're browsers rather than grazers. So the cattle will tend to graze the ground vegetation preferably, whereas deer, where they have the option, they will browse trees, particularly broadleaf trees. So although they have some similarities, the actual impact on the vegetation in the forest is quite different. And we think to have this level of impact, we'd need to have a deer density that was so high that it would damage our forest expansion, but also damage our peatlands, our bog woodlands, and some of our other important habitats.
So is this work inspiring others? And what would you like to see happen in the future?
Yeah, I hope so. And a really critical moment was when this grazing work was included within the Cairngorm's emergency plan, written by the National Park and by Nature Scott. And we've hosted a number of visits here from other capercaillie forest managers who've often gone away and got their own cattle. And I think that's really exciting because capercaillie are a really special species, still found in a few forests in Scotland, and it needs many different forest managers and landowners to, you know, do all they can to help them. And I think that the grazing is probably one of our best tools for that.
So the capercaillie population seemed quite precarious at one time, but it seems to be increasing, no doubt because of these sorts of actions. So I look forward to seeing more capercaillie in the future.
Thank you, I do too.